This is Atlas Launch Control, 1 hour, 50 minutes into the flight of the TDRS-K satellite. And joining us here at the console in the Atlas Space Flight Operations Center is Tim Dunn, our NASA Launch Director for tonight's flight. And Tim, first of all, on the surface of it, it looks like we have a happy satellite in orbit.
George, thank you for having me. Yes, indeed, we have a successful spacecraft separation. We just confirmed that via telemetry. So you might have overheard the LCC reacting and the Mission Director Center. There's a lot of happy folks out there, and we've got a customer that's quite thrilled right now to have a healthy satellite on orbit.
Take us through the countdown a little bit from when we first picked up with our coverage tonight and some of the things that we worked through to get us to a successful launch tonight.
Okay. Be glad to, George. We picked up the count on time this afternoon. We obviously knew we had some weather concerns that I'll go into a little bit. Coming into the count, we had a nice clean rocket. Range was very clean as well. And spacecraft, we were working no issues. So when we were coming down through the count, getting ready for cryo-tanking decision, the primary concern we had was with weather. Fortunately for us, the predicted weather that we thought we were going to be dealing with was an encroaching thunderstorm activity and a potential for a phase two lightning advisory, which would have had an impact on tonight's launch attempt. That front stayed well to the north, didn't have to deal with that, but in its place we had ground winds that were right on the borderline of acceptability from a structural concern for cryotanking of the Centaur. So we spent a little bit of time. We needed about an extra 10 minutes prior to our nominal, compared to our nominal polling time. I asked Launch Director for that. Our team was able to then analyze the additional data that came in. Simultaneously with that, we worked a launch vehicle issue on the Atlas V. Turned out there was a hazgas sensor, one of a few in the interstage assembly, that had failed. So we had an anomaly discussion. We were concerned about the structural impact of ground winds that were borderline. And that's why we needed just a little bit of extra time prior to going into cryogenic tanking before we were able to complete our poll. Once we worked through that, we got into a nominal timeline. We were headed toward T0 at the front end of the window. We worked just a couple of minor launch vehicle issues during cryotanking. We had a first stage booster liquid oxygen fill and drain valve that did not give us the appropriate talkback signal, but we have a contingency plan where we're able to use pressure data to tell if that fill and drain valve is opening and closing and cycling as planned. So we were able to work through that. A little bit later in the count, we had another sensor on the vehicle. Fortunately, was triply redundant. It was a pressure sensor that had given us a little bit of noisy data, so we worked through that as well. During that whole time, spacecraft, the TDRS-K spacecraft, was being turned on, rock solid, no problems at all. On the range side, the range had just a few minor issues that they were working. One of the camera sites temporarily went down, came back operational. One of the winds Doppler radar profilers went down, went non-mission capable, but the range addressed that quickly and was able to bring that back online. And then one of their upper-level winds displays was non-operational. We had redundant capability there, but again, the range team, being a great team that they are, was able to bring that component back as well. So once we got down within a half hour of launch, we were clean and green, everything looked great, and we went right on the first opening of the window at 8:48 p.m. Eastern Time, and very thrilled with that.
Well, Tim, this was a very short turnaround for United Launch Alliance to get to this point, and it's pretty short to the next one, isn't it?
Yes, it's quite short. It's going to be a quick turnaround for our team. We're going to get a little bit of rest tonight, come back in, start reviewing the data from this mission, the TDRS-K mission, and then get most of our team deployed out to Vandenberg Air Force Base in California for the LDCM mission, the Landsat Data Continuity Mission, which is currently scheduled on Atlas V from Vandenberg on the 11th of February.
Well, Tim, it's been a very intense month here, and with the LDCM coming up as well, I think we can say we've had a very successful Atlas launch campaign here in the last month or so, leading through this flight all the way up to LDCM. And I think the team, I'm sure you think, must feel they've done a very admirable job to get us through these two launches this close
Boy,
together.
yeah, I'm just thrilled with our team, George. We have just an incredibly competent team, just exceptional dedication that they have. Both the NASA government team working alongside our colleagues at United Launch Alliance, we just have one of the finest launch teams assembled, and I couldn't be more proud of them. So, George, on a personal note, I would like to make a comment about this launch. I would like to, as launch director for TDRS-K, I'd like to make a personal dedication of this launch to a special little girl, Delaney Graylick. She's a little 14-year-old girl. She's battling cystic fibrosis. She's at over in Orlando at Arnold Palmer Hospital. And I just wanted to say, Delaney, this launch was for you. So we're really thinking about you and praying for you.
Well, Tim, thanks very much, and we'll look forward to seeing you and Omar Mayez as well out at Vandenberg. And we're all on a plane out of here very shortly.
Very shortly.
So,
Looking forward to it, George.
and that will conclude our coverage of tonight's Atlas V launch with the TDRS-K Tracking and Data Relay Satellite from the Atlas Space Flight Operations Center at Cape Canaveral Air Force Station. This is Atlas Launch Control.